captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter. The ancestral lineage built pyramids. America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray, each in his own way, teaching and learning, we can work it out.
Greetings, greetings, Mwalimu Andrew. Are you online?
Greetings, I'm here, sis. I'm actually here.
Oh, okay. No, I was trying to call you via WhatsApp.
Oh, no, I've been on for the last 10 minutes.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
Good evening, brothers and sisters.
Good evening.
We'll be starting in the next 3 minutes.
Distant relatives, no matter where you're from, where you live, how near, how far, Africa, China, Japan, Afghanistan, Israel, we're all fam, we're all distant relatives. So that's why we came together, one of the reasons myself and Damien came together, because we all come from one place, and that's Africa. That's right, you too, and you, the whole world. We all family, we just spread out all over the place. So to all my distant relatives, let's take it back home.
I said, well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Who are we today? Morning to you, morning to you, man. Morning to you, love.
Hello once again, my brothers and sisters. My name is Lorraine Chuma, moderator for tonight's session. All right. And I would like to welcome you all to the fourth season of Black Education Masterclass. All right. And it's titled Creating African-Centered Solution, a curriculum known for power. And obviously, this is the fourth session that we're having today, which is the 24th of August, 2023. Now, as you know, new people join all the time, but just to explain the procedure tonight, as always, we have two Walimus who obviously will be giving a 30-minute session to speak to us, and there will be a 15-minute Q&A after each Walimu has spoken. And of course, I will introduce the first speaker and they do their presentation. And then, of course, I will open up for questions and obviously answers for them from the Walimus. Please, brothers and sisters, prepare your questions during the lecture. All right. And then I will introduce you. And obviously, then after, I will introduce the second Walimu, who's also going to have 30 minutes to speak to us, teach us, and obviously 15 minutes again for questions and obviously answers. And remember, this is an introduction series from each Mwalimu. And obviously they have to cover a huge, there's a lot of information, but we've asked them to simplify it. And obviously it will highlight three aspects that are given to us. As you know, today's session is all about philosophy. All right. I will be very strict on time. So please, like I'm saying, it is 30 minutes, 15 minutes only for question and answers. And please prepare yourselves, brothers and sisters. And of course, each Walimu, I don't want to be disrespectful. So if I do happen to interrupt you or it's because we're running out of time, as it is, I need to keep to the 30 minutes accordingly. So I hope everybody is feeling comfortable, ready, Black consciousness, and I hope everybody's got the energy, of course. And if you can all please switch on your cameras so we can all see you. And at my count of three, let's pump up our fist and say Harambe like we do always. And that's obviously pulling people together in Swahili. So can I see everybody, brothers and sisters, bo mama, na bo baba? All right, are we ready to go? In 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Harambe!
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 Harambe! Yeah. All right, so I will have my camera on, of course, and please feel free to use the chat option so that I can see if you obviously have a question or a comment, or as it is, you can obviously raise your hand. And I think I went through that quite fast, but I will be introducing the first Mwalimu in the next minute or so. I'm just trying to keep to time. Thank you so much for bearing with me. It's a bit nerve-wracking, but I think I'm moving progressively as we go. But in the interim, let me start off by introducing the first Mwalumi Baruti. His name is Mwalumi Baruti from the United States of America. And obviously his topic will be looking at the African family as an institution of power. I'll repeat that again, the African family as an institution of power. Just to give you a background of Mwalimu Baruti, He is the co-founder, co-director of Ekoben Institute and an author of 28 self-published books. He is a former faculty of the Chicago State University and Morehouse College. I like how your biography, Mwalimu Baruti, is nice and short. If I could, you probably see him when he starts teaching. So that will be our first Mwalimu with his session. And I'm not sure if I can get a cue. I know it is only 10 past 7, but I think the earlier he starts, at least it gives a little bit of more time. So Mwalimu Baruti, are you there? Are you ready to go? Mwalimu Baruti?
Lorraine, we haven't established that Mwalimu is connected. Could we perhaps start with Mwalimu Andrew, please?
Okay, not a problem. So I'll just go and read about Mwalimu Andrew Muhammad, aka the investigator. All right, so Andrew Muhammad is the founding director of the Young Leaders Academy UK, that's run several leadership academies across London. Mr. Muhammad is also the founder of UK's largest Black Parents Association. And of course, he will be taking over and going ahead with the first session. Mwalimu Andrew, are you ready?
I am ready. I'm ready.
All right, and over to you.
Okay, is it possible to share my screen, please?
Yes, you can.
Thank you very much. One second, let me just come back off that. Okay, can you see my share screen okay, everyone?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So my name is Andrew Muhammad, from the UK, but now living in Gambia. And it's an honor and a privilege to be able to speak to my brothers and sisters, wherever they may be, especially those of you on the African continent. I just want to give a special thank you to and greetings to Sister Carla and Sister Angie, who are already a part of my extended family. So yes, I'm Andrew Muhammad, and my talk tonight is basically, as I just get my things ready, is basically the chapter on how to inspire thinking young minds, okay, add creativity in our young minds, and that is what that I do. First, I'm going to take you on a little bit of a journey, if you don't mind me, and I'm going to stick within my time limit given to me, so 30 minutes starting from now. I'm looking at my time right now. And basically, the first thing I would like us just to appreciate that time waits for no one. That we, the person we are today will not be the person that we are tomorrow. So it's how we travel on that journey, which is a very personal journey, and the kind of person we become as we get older. So I'll start off with this and to remind us that time is like a river. You cannot touch the same water twice because the flow that has passed will never be the same flow that will pass you again. So in other words, enjoy every moment in which we live, every second in which we breathe, because that moment will never, ever come back again. Sorry about this. So where do I start? This was a young brother, Andrew Muhammad, just as I was starting school myself. And the reason why I post this is because my dear mother, bless her beautiful heart, she said that Andrew, in all my school reports, the teachers recognized I had lots of potential, And I was, you know, focused at school as a young boy. And it was, you know, I was like a heavenly child, so to speak. However, when I got older and I came into my teenage years, all of a sudden, these things came on my school report. Andrew lacks focus. Andrew lacks concentration. Andrew's easily distracted. Andrew is the class joker. And what it showed there, that my aptitude for education was changing, that I became a bit of a joker. And by the time I was leaving school, my focus in class, my focus to achieve high exam results was not my priority. My priority was also, I was being very immature, playing around, gravitating with a lot of my friends. And with that mindset, like many of my counterparts, we failed. And I took personally, I failed all of my exams. Again, leaving school with no ambition, I managed to get, based on contact with my brother, I managed to get a very, very mediocre job working at a department store, lifting boxes, carrying boxes onto the shop floor. And that was because of my lack of education. I became depressed. That wasn't me, but I became depressed. And my brother said to me, how do you like this job? I said, Michael, I hate this job. And he said, well, let that be a lesson. He was giving me life skills. We're going to go into my subject matter about how to inspire creativity amongst young minds. He said to me, do not have low aspirations. Do not have low ambitions. Because when you look at the word job, J-O-B, it literally means just over broke. In other words, we are not career minded. And that's what I think we should start becoming. And we're going to go into about how we can create that mindset. But we are happy just to have a job and we're on survival mode. That is not going to inspire creative thinking. And so my brother said to me, education is the key. Education. But then he broke down education, not from a school perspective, but from a holistic perspective. He said education comes from the Latin educare, which is two words put together, edu and care. Edu means to bring out, to draw out. That's where you get the word educe, or to exit. It means to bring out. Care is the genius that lies within you. And even though they say it comes from the Greek, we know it goes further than the Greek, because the care in the end of that word is re, R-E, which comes from Africa. It comes from ancient Kemet, which we now know today as a land called Egypt. But re and ra was exactly the same. And it was the power behind the sun. And so within us, we have a genie or genius that lies within us. Education is about drawing out that genius that lies within every single one of us. And when he explained it to me from that standpoint, it turned a light on. And I went back to college after failing my exams, and I smashed every exam going. And it showed that I was the same person at school that failed my exams, but just with a clearer understanding of the word education, a clearer understanding of who I was. It changed the whole scope of what I call my achievement and aspirations. And from passing and smashing all of my exams, I decided that, yes, life is about making money. And I became an underwriter in the City of London, and I was earning quite good money back in the 80s, we're talking about now. I was the only Black or African male in the building as an underwriter, and I thought I'd make I was not happy. I was not fulfilled. And that gave me the next lesson in my life. Life is more than just making money. There's got to be something that fulfills you spiritually, mentally, and psychologically. And so it moved me on to the next stage in which I learned. And I decided to walk away from that career. And I understood that we must not be afraid to start all over again. It's a new chance when we start all over again, because now we've got an opportunity to build that which we really want to have. And so I didn't leave this particular career as an underwriter until I was in my 30s, touching 40. And I decided that this was not for me, about 35 or so. I decided that this was not for me and I had to start all over again. But sometimes by starting all over again, you have to hit rock bottom. But it's in my lower state of financial wealth that my brother introduced me to the knowledge of self. And my first book or books that I read and I devoured that changed my life was the book by Malcolm X on Afro-American history. And he speaks about African civilizations all over the world. And he first introduced me to what we call Egyptian civilization. Now, as far as I was concerned, Egypt had nothing to do with Africa. The way we were taught in England that Egypt's in the Middle East, somewhere near Palestine or whatever. We just never psychologically or mentally looked up the word Egypt. And it blew my mind when I started to challenge my Malcolm X in my mind. I said, Egypt has nothing to do with Africa. Why are you lying? And when I took an atlas out and I looked up Egypt geographically, it blew my mind. I realized, oh my God, Egypt is not near Africa. Egypt is bang smack in Africa. And it made me appreciate, if I did not even know that after going to school for 11 years and then an extra 2 years higher education, then what else don't I know? And that's took me on my journey of self-discovery. And then I was introduced to Muhammad Ali's book, his autobiography, and it took me again now on a spiritual journey. And with the two combined, historical and spiritual, it answered one of the greatest questions we could ever ask ourselves. The most powerful question for an inquiring mind, a young mind, is that every child wants to know instinctively, who am I? And until we understand who we are, nothing else in life makes sense. So how do we inspire creativity in young minds? It's the first thing is to make them understand who they are. And once I started to appreciate who I was, it then started to lead me down a path of using my own self-creativity. By leaving my career in the city of London, I started a company that dealt with success, identity, and motivation. And that journey took me all over the world. It allowed me to travel all over the world and meet people from diverse backgrounds. And that was what opened my door in being able to teach young people about unlocking the genius or the God creativity that lies within every single one of them. So, number one, how do we inspire creativity amongst our youth? Number one, they must start to learn who they are. And who they are is imperative to their quest of understanding themselves and their potential. The body is the temple of God within us. Therefore, the ancient Egyptians said, man, know thyself. And so above temples and schools of learning in ancient Egypt, in ancient Kemet, how they inspired their learners, their scholars, that every single subject you learn on earth is about you. Understand that when you look in the mirror, you are looking at one of the greatest creations in the universe. Young people must be taught this. They must understand healthfully that they are not a reject of who they are. They are not black because they're cursed. They are black because they are first. History is fundamental to the understanding of our greatness. And it is more than just history of what they call slavery. Many of us, the history or the black history they would like us to focus on, the African history they would like us to focus on, deals with approximately 400 to 500 years ago, when they so-called found us in Africa doing nothing, and out of their grace and out of their mercy, they took us to the West in under chattel slavery, and that's where our history begins. I will say to you with due respect, that was when they broke our true history. African history goes way beyond any scholar. There is no one that can tell you the beginning of the African nation, of the Black nation, of the planet Earth. No matter where they go, no matter where we go, and no matter where anthropologists study, they will see civilizations of Black people, civilizations of Africans. When we go to ancient Kemet, which we call today Egypt, you'll see the greatest accomplishments that we left. We built so much in terms of the pyramids, in terms of the temples of learning, in terms of the Valley of the Kings, the Valley of the Queens, in terms of Hatshepsut's temple, in terms of Luxor and Karnak, two of the greatest universities with over 80,000 African scholars, where ancient people of Greece wrote in their own books that a Greek scholar would boast in sitting at the seat or at the feet of an African priest or an African scholar. Yeah, they will write that no matter where they went, we had African civilization from the north right down to the south, whereby we were the birth of science, of chemistry, of mathematics, of what we call spiritual concepts. All what we see today was based on this understanding. And let's not forget that when Europe was in what they call the Dark Ages, which simply means an age where there was no understanding of science, of technology, 99% of the European continent were illiterate. These are not my words. This is what they state. They were dying of famine, of pestilence, of various diseases, what they call the Black Death, that knocked out 70% of Europe's population. And if it wasn't for the so-called Moors or the Blackamoors who left North Africa, these are Black people who left North Africa and ventured into the Iberian, or what they call today the Spanish Peninsula, and laid foundation of mathematics, of science, of chemistry, and the whole realms. This was the foundation. And they actually call this period the period of enlightenment, or what they call today the Renaissance period. The word Renaissance, as we now know, is a French word, which means the reawakening. In other words, it was Africans. Before there was even a so-called slave trade, it was Africans that came and saved Europe from total death. It was Africans that introduced what they call Arabic numerals, mathematics. It was Africans that introduced the concept of a university. It was Africans that invented or brought into Europe pavements and street lamps. It was Africans that gave the science of optical science, being able to wear glasses, turning sand into glass. These were Africans, brothers and sisters. And it's very important that we teach our children this. It's very important that we teach them about the civilization of Timbuktu and the Mali Empire. It's very important that we teach our children about Mansa Musa, which even they say today was the richest human being that's ever lived, with a gross wealth of over 400 billion. 400 billion. Bill Gates has approximately 125 billion. And so, brothers and sisters, we must raise up our children to understand that they are not a curse, but they are first. They must appreciate that they are literally the mothers and fathers of civilization. And that's important. And so not only was it important for me to go into schools, colleges, and universities and try and teach this to inspire creativity, because I knew I was one of those young people who left school thinking that Africa was backward, Africa was poor, Africa was savage, because that was what I was taught. And now I began to understand that there is no 21st century without Africa, that everyone wants to claim Africa because that is the future. And so what did we do? We created...
Oh, what's happening now?
Music is on, technician.
So, is everyone okay?
Yes, we're back. You can continue.
Oh, did I cut out?
Well, there was music playing, so you can just go back a little bit. Yes, there is. Yeah. There is.
That's right. So the point I was making is that if we're going to inspire young minds, we have to create our own educational establishments that teach young people the truth about who they are. Another important aspect of inspiring young minds is that we've got to reconnect the young with the elders or those who've gone in front of them. So it's very important, because what is happening, that there's a division between our community, young and the so-called not so young, okay, brothers and sisters. And so we must establish a very effective mentoring facility whereby we as men and we as women, both men and women, can make sure that the young people do not have to make the same mistakes that we have made. How do we do that? By sitting with these young people, giving them guidance, walking with them through their various experiences, not judging them, but being able to listen and advise them. And so it's very important, because once they see that they are inspiring us by doing that which leads to their success, and they see that we're happy with their development, then I'm telling you now that all they would want to do is to make sure that they keep us happy. But there's a disconnect between our community, and this is not due to our fault. This is a lot of colonialism and so-called imperialism that has divided our community. But we must now start to work seriously in reconnecting the youth that we're trying to inspire. So again, at the various academies that I run, we must also teach the young people leadership traits. This is how you inspire them. If we allow our children to have no discipline, believe it or not, that lack of discipline will only turn on themselves and destroy their own future. Our young people want to be guided. Our young people want us to set boundaries for them. Our young people must be taught the history of great leaders. We will teach them and must teach them that all of these great leaders that went before them, all of them were aligned with universal principles. And these are universal principles that we can teach and garner today. And so, brothers and sisters, if we want to inspire young minds, we must start teaching our young people about the leadership traits that are universal around the world. And it's not based on color, class, or religion. It's based on who you are and your connection with the universe. My art. Also, what's very important to inspire a young mind is to teach our young people the true purpose of education. The true purpose of education is not to fill their minds. The true purpose of education is to free their minds. And when you're truly educated, my family, you'll understand that you would then open up the realms of your possibility. By connecting with the education within, you connect with a greater education without. And so education is not filling a pail of water, but literally education is about setting yourself on fire. Yeah, inspire yourself. And that's what's needed. And that will lead to what's called success. And another thing that I teach my young people, that success doesn't come outside of you. Success starts inside of you. We cannot make our children feel bad about who they are and expect good results. We must teach our young people that they are what we call the incubators of success. We put them in environments that feed their spiritual, mental, and psychological self-growth. Yeah? So they are the incubator of success. And then you'll realize success is not the key to happiness. Your happiness is the key to your success. But how do you teach that? How do we connect with our children to make sure that they understand this? It's very simple. We must appreciate this. We must teach to reach. If we cannot reach our young children's hearts, then forget about teaching their minds. The core of the human being is in their heart. And that's why we learn things off by heart. It's the heart that's the seat to learning. So whatever goes into the mind goes into the heart. Whatever goes into the heart goes into the mind. The mind and the heart is connected. So if we want our children's minds to be creative, we must then reach them on a spiritual and emotional level. The children understand that once they can trust you, once they know that your heart is with theirs, then you'll understand that you can then open up their own creativity, because now they are working with you with their heart, not just their minds. And so with that said, we must inspire to aspire. And when we teach with that in our minds, then our young people will literally appreciate that they can be whatever they want to be. And I use Usain Bolt as an example. When we see Usain Bolt run, he runs like no other person. Why? Is it strictly because he's better? Or is it because he has high ambitions for himself? Many of our children don't succeed, not because they're not brilliant, not because they're not gorgeous, not because they're not beautiful. Many of our children do not succeed the level that they should succeed because, for whatever reason, they have low ambitions. And if your ambition is low, then you will never achieve the greatness that you have the potential to achieve. So many of us don't achieve, not because, it's because we don't aim high and miss, we aim low and hit. And we've got to now start teaching our youth that in any pyramid, the bottom is always crowded. Everyone wants to be at the bottom, but you find more space in life when you aim to be at the top. Raise your standards, raise your ambition. But then the question should be asked to me, Andrew, how do we get young people to raise their ambitions? Very simple. Again, Usain Bolt teaches us this. Champions chase dreams, not the competition. In other words, our greatest competition in life is to create dreams and go for those dreams. Our dreams step outside of what knowledge can give us. And that's why Albert Einstein, the scientist, he says, imagination is more powerful than knowledge. If we can start thinking creatively, if we can start using our imagination, if we can start making our young people have aspirations and dreams, then you know what? We will then appreciate that they are the geniuses that they were born to be. And so I think I stayed within my time. In fact, I've done 25 minutes. So I'll end on that point. the foundation is that we must appreciate and teach our children from cradle to the grave and make them fall in love with their beautiful black selves, their beautiful African selves. Make them embrace it, make them fall in love with it, and then appreciate that they are not black because they're cursed. They are black because they are the first original people on planet Earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Molimu Andrew. Indeed, very powerful just looking and mentioning the topic on how to instill creative thinking within our youth, within our children. And, you know, for me, just listening to what you've done and what you're still doing in education, all right, in, you know, let's teach our children so that they can be able to achieve what they want to achieve and they can do whatever that they want to do. Let's encourage them that they're not limited at all, and indeed extremely powerful. I really love your statement to say, teach your children that they are not a curse, but they are first. Truly powerful, Molimu Andrew. We appreciate that, and keep up the good work, and let's keep bringing out who we are as Africans. With that being said, of course, it is 7:41 p.m., and that gives us enough time to obviously ask questions and give Molimu a chance to respond back. So for those that have questions, if you can please switch on your camera, your mic, of course, and do introduce yourself from wherever you are in the world. So is there anybody that would like to start? Any hands? Please feel free to switch on your camera and state your name, and I'll let you go ahead. I suppose I will start myself, Molimu. With everything that you've done so far and that you're still doing, how has it been received throughout the countries that you've traveled to, and what impact has it, you know, shown to the people that have obviously experienced or are experiencing what you're doing?
Yes, I mean, to be fair with you, it's been received very well. I find that many of the young people and or parents and or students are generally universally very, very, very similar, no matter where, what part of the earth they are. And we as a people, we've been through many, many shared experiences. And that's the angle I try to teach into the shared experiences, whether you may be coming from the UK, whether you may be coming from the rest of the European continent, whether you're residing in the United States or Africa. I believe that there are shared experiences, and that's what we try to tap into. And using that philosophy, it's been very well received, to be honest with you, which has allowed us to start various positive programs that have affected global programs that have taken us and allowed us to connect young people and their students to many different people around the world. And I think that this is something that we must start doing. We must start showing and demonstrating that our struggle is not a personal struggle or unique struggle just to our particular neighborhood or country. That once we start connecting, especially the young people, we start appreciating that we've got so much more in common with each other. The experiences and the solutions are very much the same. And at this present time, I'm actually working on a project, which I don't want to go into too much yet, but it's a very exciting project, which is going to be based on the motherland, based in Africa. And it's going to be a global operation, bringing young people from all over the world back to Africa to a resource center that's going to teach them not just about one particular country in Africa, all the countries in Africa, but it's going to be based in this particular resource center is going to be based in Africa. But the aim is to reconnect all of our young people back to the motherland. and make them appreciate the power of African royalty.
Absolutely. Absolutely, mon amour. All right, anyone else? We have 15 minutes. Let's maximize. Let's ask all the questions that we need to. You don't even have to ask. You can even comment if you feel you need to comment. Over to all the participants.
Everyone seems shy today, so it's not a problem. Yes.
All right, we've got a hand up. You can unmute yourself. There we go.
Yeah, thank you so much, Lorraine. Thank you so much, Mwalimu. And I'm in the dark. I hope you can see my face with this little light that I have here.
We can see you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mwalimu. I think my question is around how creative thinking is misconceived, especially in our parts, because it is usually associated with assimilating with Western cultures and traditions and stepping out of our own identity. A good example, like my mother told me a story of how when the white people came and introduced religion to them, they first tried to like even change their dress code and encourage them to get creative around it and get rid of the stuff that they used to wear and dress like white people. And I think that continues to be evident even in us as young people, that we think that getting creative is stepping out of our Africanism and assimilating with Western traditions. And you've made a statement to say, you know, like to instill creative thinking in young people, we first need to start by teaching them who they are. So my question to you is, how deep is this problem of miseducation? Because as much as we want to give the right education out there, there's a lot of miseducation that has already been done. How deep of a problem is this, and how do we prepare ourselves to take it head on?
Yes, my king, everything you just stated was right and exactly 100% on point, my young brother. This problem of miseducation is the root problem. It's not a problem. This is the root of our problem. And that's why I used myself as a case study. When I was miseducated for 11 to 13 years in the British school system, I left underachieving academically, underachieving spiritually, underachieving mentally, underachieving psychologically. But it wasn't until I was introduced to what I call true education from an African perspective, because I'm an African boy. I'm an African man. And I didn't just accept the information because it was African. I had to do my research. I had to cross-check. I had to literally verify and analyze the data. But once I realized the great lie and the deception of what we were being taught as Africans, not just in Africa, because you've got the power of colonialism in Africa, but what has happened to us worldwide in the Caribbean, in Europe and in America. This is a worldwide miseducation problem, and it's the root. And as I stated in my presentation, young brother, it's time that we start creating our own independent institutions of learning. And sometimes it may start with just a few of us coming together. It could be 5-10 of us coming together. It's great institutions start very, very small. But we've got to appreciate that we must start taking on this education as the only salvation for a cohesive community. Our sister mentioned at the beginning, Sister Lorraine mentioned Harambe, which means to pull together. These cannot be just words. We must live Harambe. And sometimes it means sacrificing for the purpose of Harambe. We must come together, even if it's just a few of us. After I was miseducated at school, I was adamant that my children, my first four children, they were not taken to the school system. because I knew what the school system was doing to our children. So my children were home educated. My children connected to other black children, African children in the UK, and we created programs that educated our children ourselves. We were not trained teachers. We were not qualified teachers. What we could do, we gave our young people and more and more. And all of my children, the first three children out of four, all came out with degrees, all came out with honorary degrees in the establishment, because they went to education first based on who they are. Man, woman, know thyself. And until we can't know God until we know self, we cannot know self until we know God. We are intricately connected. Intricately connected. We are one. So I will say once again, as I finish, knowledge of self, knowledge of who you are is the crucial thing that we must be searching for, and teach this to young people by creating our own institutions of learning, using our own scholarly books and devices.
And just reading a couple of comments coming through, with the agreement, of course, that miseducation is deep, and obviously village institution building is key, and miseducation leads to missed opportunities. Indeed, we need to come together to challenge the education system with consistent think tanks, which leads to advocates, just let me see that, groups which influence developmental support from the state, as we provide them with the land that we need to live in. Sign me up, Harambe. Thank you so much for that comment. Any other questions? Any other? There is a question coming through that says, how can we get in touch to learn from what you are doing? So, Limu, Andrew.
Yes, most definitely. I know that Sister Lorraine or Sister Shireen, is it? They've got my email address. I will say my email address right now. It's investigator37@hotmail.com. I'll actually put it in the chat room. Please, if anyone's interested in finding out more, I've just put it into the chat room. I sent it to Sheena. Didn't realize it was a direct message, but Sister Sheena can put it on to the group, to everyone. Please connect with myself. I think I mentioned at the beginning, I've moved a lot of my, I still do a lot of work. I still got my schools running, my businesses running and what have you in the United Kingdom. But I'm now building in Africa. I've just relocated and now I'm living full time in the Gambia, and we're building in Gambia now, which is going to be my first base in Africa. So this is what we're doing. Now we take this thing, we take this liberation very, very serious. We can't be part-time liberators. Yeah, we've got to really put our mind, heart, body, and soul, because the enemy that we have that do not want us to unite, that do not want our children to be educated, that do not want us to be free and self-determining, they do not take days off. They do not have weekends off. They work 24 hours, 7 days a week to make sure our children and their parents are living a life of miseducation.
Absolutely. Absolutely. They do not sleep. They are working 24/7. And I mean, they're in Gambia, absolutely fortunate. Hopefully you'll come through to South Africa, Mwalimu, because we definitely need that over here in many other parts of Africa as well. This type of education is what is needed for our children, because the systems that we're using these nowadays actually are diluting, if not giving our children the wrong perceptions. Any other questions?
And can I just add, as we're waiting for more questions, can I just quickly add, behind me, you see a red pill and a blue pill. That is a scene from a movie called The Matrix. And it was a choice that was offered to a young man called Neo. And it's a choice that we have today. We have a choice, every single one of us on this platform today. We have a choice in life to take the blue pill or the red pill. Why? What is the symbolism behind the blue pill? What is the symbolism behind the red pill? The color blue represents miseducation. It literally represents an illusion. When we look at the sky looks blue. But when you go on a plane and you try and touch that blue sky, you realize the blue doesn't exist. The ether in the atmosphere makes the sky appear blue. It's an illusion. It's deception. When you look at the deep blue ocean, the deep blue sea, you go over there, you put your cup in that water, you pour out the water, there is no blue in that sea. Blue is deception. When you put clear plates of glass on top of each other, you look down into that glass, the color looks blue. You move the glass out of the way, there is no blue. And so in life, if you're happy to be living a life of illusion, if you're happy to be easily deceived, you are already taking the blue pill. The second choice is what's called the red pill. Red represents fire. Red represents passion. Red represents love. Red represents truth. We are living in the solar system. The word solar means the sun. Without no sun, there is no life. And so when we look at the sun, it's a great ball of red hot fire. Over 2,879,785 miles in circumference. Over 825,000 miles in diameter, throwing light at a speed of 186,000 miles per second, causing the earth to rotate and change. Where there is no light, there is no life. That's red. That's coming from the red hot sun. Red represents power and truth. And so today, brothers and sisters, we have a choice. Do we want to take the blue pill or do we want to fire ourselves up and take the red pill? Which may mean pain, but that is where freedom really lies.
Absolute power. And thank you for answering that, because I was about to ask the question around the picture, the background behind you with those two pills. And absolutely so true. We're living in a world of illusion. And really, wow, I'm taken and I'm truly moved, Mwalimu Andrew. If we don't have any questions, we've got 3 minutes before Mwalimu Baruti starts. I'd like to confirm, is he connected online?
He was connected. He just dropped off again. We're trying to sort that out quick.
All right. In the interim, while we're waiting for Mwalimu Baruti, can we comment, we can ask more questions. I'm not sure, Mwalimu Andrew, if there's more you want to say, but if I can just add or comment to say, truly kids that, well, we've got family, or I have family that, you know, have kids overseas, and it's so important for them. And, you know, I wish they could connect to such platforms, because we're seeing my nieces, my nephews, wherever they are in the world, they lose themselves and they think they're no longer African or children of Africa. And it saddens me, because I always seemingly remind them that you might go and live overseas or in other parts of the world, but never forget who you are. You are an African born one, a born African, and that will never leave you. They can take you out of Africa, but Africa should never come out of you. So absolutely powerful. Absolutely powerful.
And we must also appreciate, my queen, that the education concept today is moving away from the knowledge of who you are, more moving towards the chase of materialism. And so many of us are finding that we need or strive for education because we want to earn more money. That is, from day one, you're gone on the wrong journey. True education, again, as I stress, is about finding who you are. And once you find out who you are, you better find out what is your mission aim, and purpose in life. Mm-hmm. Once you find your mission, aim, and purpose in life, you will then find true happiness in what you do on a daily basis, because you are living according to your special nature. And once you live according to who you are, and you're finding that happiness is in your heart, that's when the money will come. So I'm not trying to say to people, don't be educated, but stay poor. I would never teach that. But what I'm saying is that once you, if you go for education purely for money, you will never find true happiness. But if you find that your education is allowing you to find out who you are, you will make the money tenfold, because you're doing what you love and you're doing what's according to your special nature.
I could listen to you all night, Malumu Andrew, honestly, but we have a question quickly. It's just moved up. It says, what should our children, bear with me, brothers and sisters, kings and queens. I'm avoiding mentioning the name because I don't know if I say brother, it could be a sister. So I'd rather just read the question or the comment. But it says, what should we teach, or what should our children actually know or be taught? Most of what is taught in schools is irrelevant. So what should they be learning?
That's a very good question. They should have a healthy dose of knowledge of self. Black history is fundamental. I keep stressing that. Black African history, a knowledge of who they are, a knowledge of their people, knowledge of their culture, a knowledge of their traditions, their morals, their well-being. They need to have that holistic approach. So history is number one. Also, we need to teach them financial literacy. We need to teach them how to make money, because we are living in a world of money. So as I said, I would never teach actually and teach them to be poor. No, we must teach them financial literacy, how to be entrepreneurs, how to save, how to invest. Because they're going to live a life whereby they're going to be using money every single day of their lives. We must teach them financial literacy. We must teach them entrepreneurship. We must teach them what we call STEM, science, technology. Oh, come on, my STEM subject, science, my mind's gone blank now. Science is this STEM. If someone can remember what STEM stands for, because it's got out of my head all of a sudden, okay? But it's all the sciences subjects, okay?
Which science, includes math, technology, what is the E?
Yeah, my mind's gone black. I teach this all the time. My mind's gone
science,
black.
Science, technology, environment. No, it's...
Engineering,
mathematics, yes.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. My mind just went totally blank. But we must have a very important part of our syllabus for young people must be based on the sciences, because we are moving so quick into a world of technology. The old labor jobs are gone. That's history. We move and are living in the world of technology. 21st century is about technology, and we need to make sure our children are learning what they call nation building subject matters. Most of our young people in England, they want to do, and I'm not putting it down, you know, because it's an important part of our culture, but they want to stay in music and sport. Music and sport cannot alone build nations. We need architects. We need farmers. We need mathematicians. We need scientists. We need engineers. We need a whole, these are what you call nation building subject matters of learning. And when you are like that, you can never become redundant. You could be going all over the world, because the whole world requires those skills in order to build nations. And so it's very important that we start teaching our children these aspects. We must teach our children the art of language, because that's how we communicate with each other. That's how they destroy us in the law or the legal system, because we do not know how to master language. So we must be apt on and very well indebted into the study of language and art and even the music. But these are just some of the areas that we need to make sure our young people are learning about. And another last thing I would say, and I say this is something that inspired me, and I use it a lot in my schools, We must teach our young people about past and present great people. Because once you start studying about all those great people that lived before you, you will appreciate that there is a pattern that takes place in great leadership. Once you understand the pattern, then you can understand that you can utilize that same pattern within you. So we must start teaching our people about the greats.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Mwalimu. Honestly speaking, this has been an absolute pleasure just to listen to you. And I'm going to take a lot away because we're raising kings, we're raising queens. So it's important. And the journey I'm traveling already, it just comes together to show me or maybe just remind me that I'm actually in the right direction. So we're still struggling to get Mwalimu Baruti online. So I think we are going to take a 5 minute break. I think we should officially be back at 10 minutes past eight. Hopefully he's going to connect while we try and figure out what plan B will be in case he doesn't. But for now, you can take a small little break. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Morning to you, man. Morning to your love. Hey. I say. Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant, science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished, but Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out? Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
Who are we today? The slums, diseases, AIDS, we need that all to fade. We cannot be afraid. So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter. The ancestral lineage built pyramids, America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray? Each in his own way, teaching and learning, we can work it out. We love a warm bed, we love some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread, and we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? Lie without truth, you hear me out. Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may some more love come. Yesterday we were kings, I tell you, young blood, this world is yours today.
Dari yoteri waye naba tatire oninki torte dicha wadinke tire otam markila teso wadinke tunshe otad nikitam ai
thank y'all. Everybody out there. This is Nas, Damian Marley, distant relatives. We're all distant relatives, no matter where you from, where you live, how near, how far. Africa, China, Japan, Afghanistan, Israel. We're all fam, we're all distant relatives. So that's why we came together. One of the reasons myself and Damian came together. Cause we all come from one place, and that's Africa. That's right, you too, and you, the whole world. We all family, we just spread out all over the place. So to all my distant relatives, let's take it back home.
I say, well, Africa must wake up, sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Who are we today? Morning to you, morning to you, man. Morning to you, love.
I think. Welcome back, brothers and sisters, kings and queens. It is unfortunate. I don't think Mwalimu Baruchi has been able to connect with us. I know Mwalimu Andrew speaking about we are living in a digital world, but sometimes technology can let us down. However, please note that a recording of his teaching and session will be then sent to everybody who participated today. It happens. So the session is going to end a bit early, but I think I'll just like to read out one or two, you know, Pan-African quotes that actually relate to Mwalimu Andrew and what he was talking about. And this is by Kwame. And he says, it is clear that we must find an African solution to our problems, and that this can only be found in African unity. Divided, we are weak. United, Africa could become and is one of the greatest forces for good in the world. I think that just aligns with what Mwalimu Andrew was talking about, and embrace all, help some, trust few and harm none. To change in this world, you start by changing yourself. And I think, thank you so much, Mwalimu Andrew. Truly, it's a blessing for me, you know, as a moderator, and being part of this session has just, you know, opened my eyes a bit more and my mind indeed as to what we need to do as kings, queens, brothers and sisters, raising other kings and queens. So I'd like to find out, is there anyone else within our brothers and sisters who would like to comment? If I could ask for some closing comments, and obviously Mwalimu Andrew, if you could also make announcements or add anything else. It is 8:15. If there's anyone interested in just having closing comments, please put on your camera, introduce yourself, and switch your mic on.
Hello.
Hello, sister. Continue. Go ahead.
My name is Carla. I tend to listen to Brother Andrew's program on Tuesdays, and it's very inspiring. So it was interesting to hear what he had to say about the academies that he runs. So So yeah, I'm very supportive of them. So I think they're a good way for us to teach our young, the next generation, what we didn't know at school, and some of what Brother Andrew said resonated, because there was quite a lot about school about us that they didn't teach us at school as well. Usually started with slavery, which is usually where it starts in British schools. So yeah, it was just good to hear what he had to say when it came to teaching next generation and what we must do. And yeah, I miss that he's in the Gambia and I'm not there.
Absolutely. I'm in the same boat as you. Yes, yes.
Yeah. But yeah, it's good that we've got people like Brother Andrew to help the next generation to understand and not make the same mistakes as we did before. So yeah.
Thank you so much, Sister Carla. I appreciate it. Anybody else? Please don't be shy. I think you can see I started off a bit nervous, but I think I've sort of gone into it myself. So please feel free just to show your camera, comment, ask any questions. I think we can officially end it off at about 8:30, but this is just a platform for, you know, everyone to just speak and comment. I think, you know, it's well deserved. Anyone else? Everybody else is a bit shy. No other comment? Going once, going twice, and going three times. Molly, Andrew, anything from your side? Any announcements you'd like to make?
I would just like to say a big thank you to Sister Carla West. She's literally my ride and die. She's always there, not just for myself, but she's always there for the whole community. Wherever we do events, she's got just an inquisitive mind that wants to learn more and more and more. And, you know, it's sisters like Carla and Sister Angela that allow me to say, you know what, boy, this is not a given up journey. We've got to just delve deeper. We can all become a nation or community of people, that would just love to learn. We will be free overnight. Just the love of learning and our unity will bring us together. So I've not got much more really to say other than to my people, wherever you may be, just love who you are. When you're looking in that mirror, you're literally looking at your savior, or you could be looking at the person who's burying you every single day. So it's about appreciating that you are beautiful, you are talented, you are gorgeous, and just give yourself a hug. Don't be too hard on ourselves. Sometimes as a people, we could be really hard on ourselves. Sometimes we got to learn the spirit of forgiveness and just look at the bigger picture and just try to aim to honor your higher self, because that's who you're really trying to be. And that's the real you. And if there's anything wrong with you, it's not because of you. It's because something was done to us way, way, way before you was born that has now made you become maybe not the great person that you want to be, but there's always, every time you wake up in the morning, brothers and sisters, there's a chance and an opportunity to change your life 100% for the betterment of you, yourself, and your people.
I know the comment coming through, the message is clear, Molimu, and we give thanks for your great works and sending you lots of love and support. And we are inspired. They are inspired. We're all inspired. And just to end off by saying, the day will come when history will speak. Africa will write its own history. Yes. And it will be a history of glory and dignity. And that I will end off by a quote from Patrice Lumumba. And I think just to close it off once again, can we switch on our cameras and our mics? And at the count of three, let us pull together by saying Harambe. Counting in 3, 2, 1. Harambe!
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 Thank you so much. Harambe, thank you so much, Malimu Andrew, and to all the brothers and sisters, kings and queens from all over the world. Let us continue conveying the message. This is beautiful. This is power. And we'll meet again, I suppose, in the next session, and hopefully no technical glitches. But for now, have a blessed evening in other parts of the world, a blessed morning and afternoon. It's been a pleasure. Once again, your moderator, Lorraine Chuma. You take care. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Morning to you, man. Morning to your love. I say, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
The black oasis, ancient Africa, the sacred awaken, the sleeping giant, science, art is your creation. I dreamt that we could visit old Kemet. Your history is too complex and rigid for some Western critics. They want the whole subject diminished, but Africa's the origin of all the world's religions. We praise bridges that carried us over the battlefronts of Sudanic soldiers, the task put before us.
You hear me out? Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today?
Who are we today? The slums, diseases, AIDS, we need that all to fade. We cannot be afraid. So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter. The ancestral lineage built pyramids, America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from now waters. The first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray? Each in his own way, teaching and learning, we can work it out. We love a warm bed, we love some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread, and we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? Lie without truth, you hear me out. Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up, you sleeping sons of Jacob, for what tomorrow may bring, may some more love come. Yesterday we were kings, I tell you, young blood, this world is yours today.
Daddy, oh, daddy, why ye? Never the tire. On ninki torte dicha, why didn't get the ire? On the marquilla teso, why didn't get the unche? On the hat ninki tum ay, why didn't get the he? Daddy, oh, daddy, why ye? Never the tire. On ninki torte dicha, why didn't get the ire? On the marquilla teso, why didn't get the unche? On the hat ninki tum ay, why didn't get the he?
want to thank y'all, everybody out there. This is Nas, Damian Marley, distant relatives. We're all distant relatives, no matter where you from, where you live, how near, how far. Africa, China, Japan, Afghanistan, Israel. We're all fam, we're all distant relatives. So that's why we came together. One of the reasons myself and Damian came together. Cause we all come from one place, and that's Africa. That's right, you too, and you, the whole world. We all family, we just spread out all over the place. So to all my distant relatives, let's take it back home, man.
Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, now. Well, Africa must wake up, the sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. Yesterday we were kings, can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Morning to you, morning to you, man. Morning to you, love.